Welcome, we'll understand the Yojana October issue 2017 where we talk about New India. Now just a reminder for many of you, we have started a separate Hindi channel in the name of Examrace Hindi. So those from Hindi medium can definitely refer the same lectures there. We are trying to cover most of the lectures there as well. Now coming on to the topic, the Yojana October 2017 which talks about New India. Now here let's start with the Quit India Resolution in 1942 and we'll have a kind of brief background as to why we are understanding the idea of New India. So what happened in 1942 was we started with a Quit India movement and finally in 1947 we gained independence. So it was a period of 5 years and these 5 years was in the year 1942 we thought about something that was the Sankalp and in 1947 we achieved it, that was the Siddhi, and similarly is what we'd want to go forward with. So 2017 would be the year of Sankalp and finally 2022 would be the year of Siddhi or attainment. Now this time we wanted freedom from the British Empire, however now we want freedom from the dirt or the filth, from poverty, from corruption, from terrorism, from communalism and casteism. So this is the motto of New India. We want a New India in the next 5 years which is free from any kind of dirt, free from poverty, free from corruption, free from terrorism, communalism and casteism. So these 6 things would be the focus of this issue. We'll be talking about each of these one by one. So let's start with the first one, that's Clean India. Now we want to declare India as open defecation free by 2019. That's the 150th anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. Now open defecation is the cause of nearly 1 lakh deaths every year and that is mainly due to diarrhea. 40% of the stunted growth is due to lack of sanitation and it costs around 6% of the GDP. That's a very big figure. What we have tried to achieve under Swachh Bharat mission is to increase the sanitation cover from 39% to 68%. 5 states have already been declared ODF, that's open defecation free, which includes Sikkim, Himachal Pradesh, Kerala, Haryana and Uttarakhand. The reach has went to nearly 230 million people. Now what is our focus is from shifting from the output to the outcome. So output is simply building up more toilets, but we are shifting to an outcome, that is open defecation free villages, and what we want is a behavioral change or the change in the habit of an individual. Again, there were various efforts that were launched for the same. So we tried to introduce the Swachh Bharat Divas. Amitabh Bachchan was a campaign for the TV program where he talked about Darwaza Band. Then you had a Jan Andolan which talked about cleanliness as service and asked for volunteers for cleaning society. Then you have Swachh Iconic Places and Swachh Action Plans, which were the various sites given by various departments and awarded based on that. Swachhathon was launched, which was a Swachh Bharat Hackathon, and it invited innovative solutions, technology based solutions for development. So safe disposal, low cost solutions. A lot of film, essay and painting competitions were organized to bring in new ideas and ask for innovative ideas for the same. Now coming on to the rural India, working around the issue of poverty. When we talk about rural India, we say we have nearly 69% of the rural households with less than 1 hectare of the land and many of them are landless. Again, there are 8.85 crore households which are even deprived of the basic amenities. So as a result, Mission Antodaya was started and this Mission Antodaya talked about a kind of multidimensional removal of poverty. There were various forms in which self-help groups have helped. So there were nearly 70,000 crore of bank loans that were sanctioned by the to the self-help groups. Subsidy was given on wheat and rice. Awas Yojana Grameen aims to build nearly 1 crore houses for the rural poor. 60% of the expenditure in rural area goes to the agriculture and allied activity. Under MINAGRA, that is 100 days of minimum work, this project has been the highest employer in the last 5 years with nearly 235 crore persons per day, 235 crore persons days per year, and the maximum expenditure from this scheme has gone to poultry, dairy and goat schemes. Numerous programs have been asked for where individuals have been involved. For example, Meri Sadak app that talks about feedback on the status of road, Awas app that talks about uploading the pictures of the houses built under the Awas scheme. Then you have the development of the cadre for social auditors. A lot of transparency has been brought in by Aadhaar, the direct benefit transfer scheme. So what has now happened is nearly 100% payment under the Awas scheme Grameen goes directly into the bank accounts. So there is no issue of fake payments, no issue of duplicate payments, no issue of intermediaries being involved. Now space, with the space technology, 100% geotagging has been done for the Awas Grameen scheme. Bank loans have been sanctioned for self-help groups for women. Now the connectivity has increased with the road construction that has increased from 70 kilometers per day to nearly 130 kilometers per day. And most of these road constructions now use green technology, fly ash and self-filled concrete. So these are kind of innovative solutions to remove the waste. Skill upgradation is again an important parameter where the individuals are being trained for certain skills. Handicraft and handloom centers have come up. Innovation have been laid a very good pace with solid resource management in 80% of the villages in Tamil Nadu and liquid resource management in Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra and Telangana. So evidence-based monitoring is another major thing. Now caste-free India, this is something that has been going on for more than 2000 years in India when we started with the four varn system. So Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Kayas. So you had the four varn system, the Vaishya and Shudra. So you had the four varn system that existed, and it was the first time where the decennial census was started during the British period in 1871. They started with a divide and rule policy and they tried to break down India based on the caste. However, after 1947, these caste groups started to maintain their own identity, and as a result, they tried to mix up among only themselves, breaking out the kind of social mobilization that exists in the society, and people started to have a kind of blind faith in one's own caste. So there was a huge casteism that was promoted during that time. This also helped people during the election process. So there were kind of pressure groups, violent protests were taken up and they asked for reservations and quotas. However, what we aim to do is now is reduce the casteism by providing education, checking out or mobilizing the voters, checking out the role of election commission in removing any kind of electoral politics, and create a kind of equal platform based on social and economic strata. The next is the developments in the agricultural field. Now agriculture, we aim to double the income by 2022. However, only 14% of the GDP comes from the 55% of the workforce that is involved into agriculture. So we definitely need to increase this GDP. We have registered the highest production of food grains this year. That is due to the efforts of the farmers, the innovation, the extensive personal and stakeholders' ability. The drip irrigation in the country has increased drastically from 4.25% to 8.39%. So it has nearly doubled during this period, and there is a lot of private and public investment coming up in agriculture. Soil health cards have come up that aim to improve the fertility and enhance the productivity of the soil. The cropping intensity has increased for the fallow areas. For the post-processing, there are now cold storage chains, ripening chambers and pack houses. Then milk procurement, which was previously from only 16,000 villages, has now strengthened up to 50,000 villages. We have created a National Livestock Development Agency. A lot of R&D has gone into genomics and biofortification. Then you have thermostolerant vaccines for animals that have come up. We have gone forward with organic farming rather than the NPK fertilizers that were used during the time of Green Revolution. We are moving towards an evergreen revolution, and that talks about Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. So every farmer gets 50,000 rupees as a financial assistance, and the area under organic farming has increased by 17%. Under the Fasal Bima Yojana, it's a kind of insurance scheme for all food grains and commercial crops and on one season, one rate basis. So it covers nearly 5.75 crore farmers now. E-Nam is a portal where we have integrated all the agricultural mandis online, and this has become a kind of transparent process. It has increased the, it is said that 13% increase in the crop price would lead to 9% increase in the farmers' income. So increasing the farmers' income is again an important idea that we are moving forward. We are going towards an integrated farming which focuses on resource conservation and diversifying to high value crops. Again, the Ministry of Agriculture has now been called since 2015 as Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare. The next is Triple Talaq, which talks about liberating women. So this was a decision that has that talked about, till now the system was the talaq could be given with simply uttering the word talaq three times. Now this decision has been taken keeping in mind the Shah Bano case. Five judges were set. It was 3-2 majority. So three judges said that this is unconstitutional. Those were Justice Kurian Joseph, R.F. Nariman and U.U. Lalit. However, two justices, that is Kherkar and Abdul Nazir, believe that it is a matter of Muslim Personal Law Board and it should not be a part of the court system, should not interfere in the same. So this talked about violating the law, the Article 14 that talks about right to equality. And finally, the court has asked or given 6 months time to frame a new law. So it was, the reasons for the favor of this was, most of the Muslim nations have already terminated this, so why should it exist in India? Again, Allah never believed in talaq, and most of the provisions, even in the Quran and Hadith, do not talk about the provision for triple talaq. Most of the women when voted wanted that this should happen and this should be removed. Now next is innovation-led reforms, very important. With the Atal Innovation Mission, we are moving forward with a kind of creativity, curiosity among the young and the youth. So, under the Champions of Change, it talked about bringing entrepreneurs from different fields and having a dialogue with the government with a kind of open mind and a 360 degree view. So it talks about removing nearly 1,200 laws which exist but are inefficient and are of no use. Bring in more financial assistance for the rural poor and a kind of transparent growth. Now some of the solutions that were laid forward, here are some of the very good examples. In Chhattisgarh, it's kind of region specific. So Chhattisgarh is known for the mining, and there a mining detection device was made with a sound technology controlled by Bluetooth, which is much faster than the existing system. Similarly, a method was devised for visually impaired people by Uttarahali in Bangalore, and they talked about bringing in wearable device for blind and that can detect obstacles even by ultrasonic waves. Later on, we talked about checking the problem of bulky fire extinguishers running on narrow roads. So there should be a kind of low cost and easy solution for fire extinguishing. Next is Maligaon, Assam. The students developed a kind of system to detect the level of waters and alert the commuters through the mobile network about the status of water in different areas. So what Dr. Kalam talked about was make students think out of the box, bring in curiosity, bring in creativity and bring in innovation. And he rightly said that one must have great aims in life, as aiming low is a crime. So one must aim higher in life to achieve the goals. So Atal Innovation Lab talks about, has already gone in 33 states with 941 schools and covered 55% districts. It aims to expand to nearly 1,300 more labs. The next is zero tolerance to corruption. Now some of the efforts that have been done is, First of all, the government is moving forward with minimum government and maximum government. So minimum people and maximum governance. So all the, let's say the GST platform is totally online. IT platform, the income tax department is going online. So they are reducing the role of intermediaries, reducing the role of people in the function. Then the attestation by the government servant is no more compulsory. There is abolition of personal interviews for recruitments in most of the positions. Inefficient public servants have been removed. Demonetization of high denomination currency. Online auction of coal blocks. Then ending the tax havens in Europe and other European nations, other nations. Some of the efforts include Prevention of Corruption Act, the independent role of Central Vigilance Commission, Lokpal Lok Ayuk Act, Whistleblowers Protection Act, and Prevention of Money Laundering and Benami Transaction. Now, DBT is Direct Benefit Transfer by Aadhaar Scheme. 82% of the DBT beneficiaries are now seated with Aadhaar card. For the transparent government, we aim to go for a BHIM app. IMPS, NEFT, RTGC and electronic clearing systems are all way forward to bring in a kind of transparent governance. Sanatham committee talked about four major causes for corruption. First is the administrative delay. The second is government taking upon themselves more than what they actually could manage, bringing in more cumbersome and tedious process. And finally is the scope of the personal discretion for exercising the powers by different public servants. So if all these are checked, the corruption would automatically be checked. The idea is to strengthen the audit and accounts process. So it talked about merging the rail budget and the general budget, merging the non-plan and the plan expenditure, introduction of GST and opening up the foreign direct investment in India. Lokpal and Lok Ayuk talked about conducting a primary inquiry on the complaints which are referred by the Lokpal for group B, C and D officers. For group A, it would be by the Directorate of Inquiry. Whistleblowers Protection Bill in 2015 talks about incorporating the provisions that aim to safeguard against the disclosure that affects the sovereignty of India. The next is Benami transaction. It was amended in 2016 and brought into effect after demonetization on 1st November. And it talks basically about bringing in income tax authorities to attach to the Benami property, which can be confiscated. The term could be from 1 year to 7 years of jail term, and 25% of the fair market value would be the fine in the case of Benami property. The next is the skill development for the youth. Now, skill development for the youth, we say India is the largest economy with an average GDP of 7% in the last 20 years. So we have a good potential, and among the developing nations, we are a newly industrialized economy. 50% of the workforce is self-employed, and the working population is assumed would reach 170 million by 2020. So what is important is to develop the skills. What presently lacks is the quality, the lack of employment and a higher dropouts from school and college level. So we have to meet or match this demand supply mismatch, create a kind of sustainable training program and facilitate infrastructure. We have to open up more Kaushal Vikas Kendra for gainful employment and training based on prior learning. So development of soft skills and development on the international levels is very, very important. Now, the role of women is no doubt important. So there are various articles that have been given for women empowerment. All women are equal under Article 14. Article 15 talks about no discrimination by the state. Article 16 talks about equal opportunity. Article 39D talks about equal pay for equal work, and Article 51AE talks about renouncing any practice that is derogatory to the dignity of the female. So all those articles work for the development or promoting the women to job. If we look onto the statistics, in India, the female work participation is only 25% as compared to Somalia, which Somalia in Africa has 37%. So Indian female have a very low work participation rate. Again, the budget spending was 28,000 crore in 2006, which has gone to 90,000 crore in 2016-17. And we say 2016-17 was a gender responsive budget. We have separated The Ministry of Women and Child Development from the Ministry of Human Resource Development in 2006, National Commission of Women has come up in 1992 as an apex body to safeguard the women right. Some of the scheme includes Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, Ujwala Yojana to prevent traffic. Then you have Swadhar Grah that talks about scheme for women in difficult circumstances, and Rajiv Gandhi National Crèche scheme for children and children of working mothers. Now we have gender budget initiatives which are in the form of two schemes. First is 100% provision for the women, and second is schemes where allocation is at least 30% for the females. India's position for the global gender gap index is 87. However, when it comes to India's health, the women health, it's 142, which is far behind, and only few countries are below India. So we definitely need to improve on women health. We also aim to go for a kind of gender budgeting, and it's when Jawaharlal Nehru rightly said that you can tell the state of a nation by looking at the condition or the status of the female. So that's very, very important. The next is the bullet train project. Now, bullet train project has been started from Mumbai to Ahmedabad, and known as Mumbai Ahmedabad High Speed Rail Project Mahasar. This is an agreement between Make in India and Transfer of Technology between the Department of Industries in India and Japan External Trade Organization. So this will be the route from Ahmedabad to Mumbai. Now, most of the route would be over water, but there would be an undersea tunnel, which is one of the key characteristics. India has got loan from Japan for 88,000 crores at a very low interest of 0.1%, which with a repayment of 50 years. Now, this is very much lower than the loans we get from World Bank, which is at 5 to 7%, and the repayment year is only 20 to 30 years. Here we have interest rate at 0.1%, which is far less than the World Bank, and again the repayment time is much higher, which is 50 years, and 81% of the cost would be borne up by Japan right now. And for the first 15 years, the repayment would begin after the 15 years of receiving the loan from Japan. It would employ nearly 20,000 workers, and the time would be reduced from 7 to 8 hours to only 2 hours. Again, this, to develop this, there is a high speed rail training institution that is to be come up in Vadodara. It would be functional by 2020, and it would have 4,000 staff which would be trained in the next 3 years. From India, nearly 300 officers have gone to Japan for the training, and the best features of this are the delay is less than 1 minute with zero fatality. It is highly reliable, highly safe. It is safe for operations even during natural calamities like earthquake. Later on, we plan to go for bullet trains on Delhi-Kolkata, Delhi-Mumbai, Mumbai-Chennai, Delhi-Chandigarh, Mumbai-Nagpur and Delhi-Nagpur routes. So with this, we covered the basic highlights of Yojana October 2017. We'll be continuing this series on Yojana and Kurukshetra every month in the upcoming months. So stay tuned at our channel and do subscribe. Have a very good day ahead.